Good afternoon, dear students. Today I am going to start your paper C, from which I am going to start the section B first. So from section B, I am starting the chapter that is electromagnetic induction. In your lower classes, you might have learnt about electromagnetic induction and Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. So first of all, let us try and understand what is the meaning of electromagnetic induction. So my dear students, in your lower classes, you might have learnt that whenever magnetic flux linked with an electrical circuit changes, an EMF is set up in the circuit known as induced EMF. So this phenomenon of inducing an EMF in the circuit whenever magnetic flux linked with the circuit is changed is called electromagnetic induction or induced electromagnetic force. Now in this chapter, the very first topic I am going to start over here is Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction that you might have done in your 10 plus 2 class. Now first of all, see, Faraday, it is the name of the scientist who discovered these laws, and after his name, the laws are known as Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. So Faraday, based on his experiments, he gave two important laws which are combined into one equation known as Faraday's laws. So these are stated as, first law states that whenever the magnetic flux linked with a circuit or closed circuit changes, an EMF is induced in the circuit whose magnitude is directly proportional to the rate of change of the magnetic flux. The second law is simply governing the sign of the induced magnetic flux, or you can say induced current. Now this law states that the direction of the induced EMF is such that so as to oppose the cause responsible for changing the magnetic flux. So suppose a circuit has magnetic flux phi m, which is changing with time. It is linked with the closed circuit. So according to by the combination of these two laws, I can write the induced voltage as chi. This symbol is known as chi, which is the symbol for the induced voltage. It is simply negative of d phi m upon dt, means the rate of change of magnetic flux with a negative sign over here. Now see here, chi is known to be the induced EMF, or you can say induced voltage, just by changing the flux phi m. The negative sign in equation number 1 here, signs describes the direction of the induced EMF. Now a little bit later, I'll explain you what does this negative sign signify. How does this negative sign appears over here? So from this equation, first of all, let us derive the integral form of Faraday's laws. So consider a closed surface S, consider an open surface S bounded by a closed curve C. In this surface, I have considered that the magnetic lines of force are crossing like this. So you can see from the diagram that magnetic lines of force are not constant. That means magnetic field B is a changing magnetic field. If magnetic field B is changing, it means magnetic flux linked with the circuit or the surface also changing. Now see, consider a surface S bounded by a closed path C. Let the magnetic field B vector is changing through the surface S with time t. So the total magnetic flux through this open surface can be written as phi m, the surface integration of B vector. So you might have learned this formula in your lower classes. Whenever the magnetic flux or flux of any vector quantity is to be calculated, you simply have to take the dot product of that vector with the area vector. That will give you the magnetic flux or the flux of that vector linked with that circuit. Now here, B vector is non-uniform. You can see it easily from the diagram. B vector is not constant, it is non-uniform. That is, it is depending upon the space as well as time coordinates. Now, I am going to use this equation number 1 in your equation number 2 in equation number 1. I will get the induced voltage chi, it is minus d upon dt of phi m. Phi m stands for B dot ds, the open surface integration. So taking this derivative sign in the integral but making it partial derivative, I write this equation in the form of equation number 3. Now this third equation is known as integral form of Gauss's law or integral form of Faraday's laws. Now from this integral form, I can go for the differential form also. So let us derive the differential form of Gauss's law. How can I divide? Now see, in our previous semester, semester 1, we have clearly understood that the line, closed line integral of electric field gives the potential difference or electric potential set up in that circuit. So electric potential is nothing but the induced voltage over here. So I know work done is equal to E dot dr, which is simply giving me the electric potential or induced voltage set up in that circuit. So I have written over here as a line as EMF in the circuit is defined as the amount of work done in taking a unit positive charge around the circuit. So accordingly, I have written the potential equation as induced voltage is equal to closed line integral of the electric field. Here E vector is the electric field induced in the circuit, that is, it is an induced electric field which has been produced due to the varying magnetic flux. Alright, now you can compare this equation 4 with your equation number 3. So in the left hand side I write the same equation, on the right hand side I write the value of chi in the integral form. Now this is your equation number 5. So students, in your previous semester, we have understood the Stokes theorem. We have done the Stokes theorem, which converts a closed line integral into a surface integral. So this Stokes theorem states that the closed line integral of a vector field is equal to the open surface integration of curl of that vector field. Just by applying this Stokes theorem on the left hand side, I'll get this type of equation. Now, differentiating both sides twice, so I'll get del cross E is equal to right hand side, it is minus curly B upon curly T. This is known as the differential form of Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. Now equation 6, it clearly indicates that the changing magnetic field, see here it is curly B upon curly T, that means magnetic flux, or you can say magnetic field, is changing with time. So whenever magnetic field is changing with time, it sets up an electric field in the circuit which is not constant. This electric field is varying with space coordinates. That means this equation clearly indicates that changing magnetic flux or changing magnetic field produces a space varying electric field in the circuit. This means that there is another source of electric field besides the stationary charges. Till now, students, you might have learned that electric field produced by the stationary charges. You have derived their formulae as well. Electric field is always produced by stationary charge. But from this equation, we have learned a new thing, that time-varying magnetic field can also be a source of the space-varying electric field. There is another source of electric field except the stationary charges. This source of induced electric field is the time varying magnetic field. Now here comes the special case. What is the special case is that if we consider the magnetic field B is uniform, that means it is not changing, it is constant. If it is constant, that means curly B upon curly T is zero. Derivative of a constant is always equal to zero. So right hand side becomes zero. You mean to say del cross E is equal to zero, which is the basic equation of electrostatic. You might have done that equation in your first semester, in which we have proved that the electric field is conservative in nature. That means when the source of electric field is not the time varying magnetic field, the electric field's curl must be zero. This is the basic equation of electrostatics. So from equations 7 and 8, we consider that induced electric field is non-conservative because, see, its curl is not zero. If its curl is zero, it is a conservative electric field. So it is non-conservative as its curl is not zero, and it can't be expressed as the negative gradient of a scalar function. So this electric field whose curl is not equal to zero cannot be expressed as negative gradient of the electric potential, whereas this electric field whose curl is zero, it is obviously the conservative electric field, and this can be expressed as a negative gradient of some electric potential, you can see. Alright, now thus The induced electric field has a different source. This might be noted over here that the induced electric field is not the same as the electric field produced by a stationary charge. It has a different source and different nature as compared to the electric field produced by static charges. This is all about the Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. Now come to what are your Lenz's law. See, Lenz's law is the verbal statement or verbalization of the negative sign that must appear in your Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction, students. Now see, what does this mean? You might have learned the statement son opposes father. So what does it mean? Means a son is being born by a father, but when later on the son grows up, he opposes his father. This is the meaning of this line. This is the simple verbalization of Lenz's law. Here I must say that what is the statement of this Lenz's law? It states that the direction of induced EMF or induced current in a circuit is such that it opposes the cause which produces it. That is why it is known to be son opposes father. Now see over here, induced current, or you can say induced voltage, it is always produced due to the magnetic flux which is changing. So once a current or voltage is set up in the circuit, this induced current or voltage, they oppose any change in the magnetic flux linked with the circuit. That is why the negative sign is there in the Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. The induced EMF and induced current in a circuit are due to change in magnetic flux linked with the circuit, but the induced current itself produces a magnetic field at hence magnetic flux through the circuit. This magnetic flux may have the same sign as the original flux, or it may have the opposite sign. Lenz's law in fact states that the sign of the induced magnetic flux must be, so see note over here, it is must be opposite to that of the flux which causes it. That is why this is the verbalization of the negative sign in the Lenz's law, or you can say Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. Our next topic is displacement current. See, what is the meaning of this displacement current? Displacement current is similar to that kind of the conduction current. As we know, conduction current density is a J vector. So I will simply write the displacement current density as JD vector. This is known to be displacement current density. Means the displacement current per unit area. So ID, it is simply JD vector dot DS vector, the surface integration. So how does this equation comes out to be? You know the definition of JD. It is DID upon DS. On cross multiplying, you will get DID equal to JD dot DS. Taking integration on both sides, you will get ID, DID the integration, it is ID, and right hand side the integration comes out to be as equation number 9. Now here, this is what you have to cram over here. This is for your CTM, commit to memory. That means the displacement current density is simply given by epsilon naught into curly E upon curly T. Actually JD is simply curly D upon curly T. The D over here is epsilon naught into E. It comes out to be equation number 10. So now using equation 10 in equation number 9, I'll get this type of equation. Taking epsilon naught out of the integration sign, I'll get this equation. Now see, what is the meaning of E dot ds? It is simply the flux phi, electric flux through the surface S. So I will write equation 10 in the form of equation number 11. So hence the displacement current comes out to be epsilon naught times the rate of change of the electric flux. This is the actual transport of charge. Equation 11 shows that displacement current, which does not the actual transport of charge, it is simply set up in the circuit because electric flux linked with the circuit is changing, and that becomes the displacement currents. The next topic is our Maxwell's equation. So I want to discuss now the Maxwell's equations, because these equations have already been discussed in very much details. You have to do these Maxwell's equations by your own. Thank you so much.